Hi, everybody. We'll just wait a few moments for everybody to come out of the waiting room into the meeting. We won't be very long. Thank you. We've got almost 100 with us now. All right, I think we're just about ready to go. Thank you all for being here. We really appreciate your generosity as always in being part of our wonderful community and helping to shape the future of the NDIS. Before we get started, I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands on which we're all meeting. I'm coming to you this morning from Wurundjeri lands, and I'd like to pay my respects to elders past and present. I'd also like to acknowledge any First Nations people that we have here in the Zoom or watching via live stream or watching in the future on a pre-recorded video. And I also want to acknowledge all the people with disability, your family members and workers and advocates who have come before us and done a lot of really hard work to get us to this point. So thank you. Before I introduce our guests, I will just run through a few housekeeping things. So because this is set up a bit differently than the way that we'd normally do things, we've got a Zoom forum with about 100 or so people, and we've asked for the Zoom forum people to primarily be people with disability, family members and or advocates or other supporters who have been through the AAT process themselves in some way and are keen to engage. But because we don't want anybody to miss out, we've limited the number of people so that you all here in the Zoom get a decent chance of having a say, even though we've only got an hour, so I'll try not to ramble on too much. But we also have people tuning in from Facebook and YouTube. I think we might have been having some tech problems over at one of them, so hopefully it's resolved. But for all of us here in the Zoom, we always appreciate you having cameras on if you're comfortable with that. But I would like to let you know that we, because it is public in the sense that people in the live streams are able to watch, that means that anybody is able to watch. And we have reason to believe there might be some media watching, and, you know, it could be anybody. So if you're not comfortable with that for any reason, that's completely fine. You're welcome to turn your camera off or change your name or use an alias, just whatever you feel really comfortable with. In addition to that, we've got, as you can see, we've got Chelsea and I'm sorry, I've forgotten your name. We've got two Auslan interpreters that will be taking it in turns to interpret the English. And I have just reminded myself that I'm probably speaking too quickly. So I'll just take it a bit easy there. Sorry, Chelsea. and we also have live captioning. So if you're in the Zoom, you should be able to click the CC button down the bottom to bring it up via Zoom. And we'll also post a link in the chat very shortly, which you can click to open the transcript in a new browser window, which some people find easier. And if there are any, thank you, Sophie. And that's brings me to my next point. Sophie is on tech support today. So for those of us in the Zoom, we can you can send her private messages in there or public if you need any, if you're having any problems with the tech. Because it is quite a large group, we've got it sort of defaulted so that everyone except for our guests are by default, not able to use the microphone, but we do want to hear from you all, or as many of you as possible. So when we get to that point, we will, our tech support, probably Sophie, will weave her magic and click a button that allows you to come off mute, but you then will have to respond by accepting it or not. It's a bit tricky, but it makes it life easier for our interpreters and our captioners. All right, I think that's everything housekeeping. So the reason that we're here is because, as you all know firsthand, the last few years, particularly the last 12 months, have been really, really difficult. We've seen record numbers of people with disability having to go to the AAT to do external appeals to try and get things sorted out. And it's been really hard, and everybody in our community has been just really wonderful in supporting each other where they can, so that we can make sure that this is an issue that we can get sorted out. And thankfully, we have a new minister for the NDIS now, Bill Shorten. Thank you, Minister. And we have a new chief counsel at the NDIA, Matt Swainson, who you can see above too. Matt's been there for a few months. And so I've been having some conversations with both the minister and Matt and people in the teams, and so have some other groups, but we decided that it was a good idea to open the conversation up to all of you. So thank you for being here, and we hope that today is a new beginning for the way that our community works with the NDIA and the Minister for the NDIS. And I really appreciate Matt and Minister Shorten taking a leap of faith here and joining us to hear from you about what's important. So I'll just give you a quick outline of what you can expect from today. So the first up, we will we'll do early on, we'll do a little mood check. We've got a little tech tool called Civility, and we'll use that at three points throughout this forum. It will help us, especially the visual learners amongst us, get a sense of how people are feeling, what matters, what's important, what we want to see change. But I do want to also, and I will remind you all throughout the forum that we, this isn't our only opportunity to give feedback and be heard. We've got more stuff on the website, and we're hoping that this is just the beginning of a much larger conversation. So we'll begin with a mood check, and then we will hear from Minister Shorten, and then we'll hear from Chief Counsel Matthew Swainson. Then we'll have a chance to have some questions from the audience, and we'll also follow up with other things that you think is important for the minister and for the NDIA to hear, particularly around what you'd like to see changed with the appeals system and in response to what we're about to hear from them both. So we won't be able to give you all the answers today. I assume Minister and Matt won't be able to give us all the answers, but we'll do our best to do everything we can, and we'll collect everything and we'll follow up with them afterwards as well. You know, we will also, it's going to be tricky for them to address or make promises about individual cases, I think, at this point. But I think maybe one of the sort of more powerful things that we can all use this sort of moment together for is to make it sort of easier for the people who are making decisions. It's not just the two of them, it's others too, who we hope are tuning in, to see how some of these issues that affect you all as individuals are systemic, that is, that they affect lots of people in similar ways, and if we can address the sort of root causes and problems for you and other people, hopefully that will make a really significant difference. All right, so I will try and move on. I think it'd be good to hear how you're all feeling right now about how things have been and are for you right now with the appeals process. So Sophie is going to pop a link in the chat, which will take you to a tool called Civility, which is a bit like Menti, if anybody's used that before. And this will just let us sort of get a sense of how people are feeling right now. So Sophie, you've got to... There we go. So this might not work for everybody. You don't have to do it if you don't want to, but we will. We have tested it for accessibility. We want to make it easy to use. If you have any problems with it, you can ask Sophie in the chat. She might be able to help, but also we'll make this available offline afterwards too. So what we've got now on the screen is... EAC AAT consult. There's text on the left. It says go to www.menti.com and then enter the code 6169702. I'll say that again, menti.com, and then the code is 6169702. And there's also a QR code, so that means you can get your smartphone out, camera, and if you just hover over the QR code, it'll bring a link up which allows you to open it. Once you've opened it, there's a button with a love heart on it. If you hit that, it allows us to see how many people have joined in, and I can see that we've got about 70 or so increasing. And the next option Sophie will bring up is the question for the mood check. Here we go. So after you've pressed the love heart, what one word would you use to describe the NDIS appeals process? So I think I can have some guesses about people's words to describe how they feel about the AAT appeals process. Once you've thought about that and popped it in, we'll read out the answers and then come up on the screen too. Is that right, Sophie? There we go. Okay, so we've got a word cloud on the screen now. It's moving around. The biggest word by far is frustrating, followed by traumatizing, traumatic, complex, exhausting, difficult, disgraceful, soul-destroying, unnecessary, confusing, inaccessible. There's many more. We will share the results of this a bit more thoroughly afterwards, but I think that helps us show how this has made people feel if anyone was in doubt. So hopefully that's the end of that now. Thank you. You can also pop your answers into the chat as well. We'd appreciate that also. So thank you all. That's a bit of a tricky one for the minister to follow. Not that he's unaware. Minister Shorten joined us at the rally that we held shortly before the election, which we're really grateful for. So thank you, Minister, for always listening to our community and being here today. I'll let you address our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. I'd like to acknowledge that wherever you are in Australia for this session, you're on Aboriginal land, always was, always is, and I pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging. I think we need to just be very truthful here. I think that the agency, and I'm now the minister of the agency, must acknowledge that things have been bad. The internal review process, opaque, unaccountable, the AAT process complex, frustrating. It's been, in my opinion, in most cases, broken. Under the previous Liberal government, the number of participants in the NDIA seeking external review of planning decisions increased by 400%. Appeals as a proportion of the participants more than doubled. Since being elected, my office is inundated with people experiencing problems. I think under the previous Liberal ministers, there were about 250 matters a month that the politicians would get in that office. We're at 1,250 a month. After the election in May of this year, the end of May, there were 4,501 active cases in the AAT. That's what we've inherited. I committed before the election to tackling this glaring problem. I pledged that we would have an alternative dispute mechanism to make the appeals process better for people with disability. I'm here today to ask you and to hear from you about the way to roll out this commitment. The NDIA, and I acknowledge Chief Counsel Matt Swainson's here, and I want to reveal the real problems with the review and the NDIS processes. We're here to listen and to gather the most practical ideas. Your feedback will help shape a pilot to trial a model for alternative dispute resolution. I'm determined to put people with disability back at the centre of the NDIS. The conversation today is a small part of Labor's commitment for proper co-design and consultation. I think the first conversation in an ongoing dialogue that I want to have with you about the best way to address the AAT is this. I want to rebuild trust that we can work together to fix problems in the schemes. I acknowledge the NDIA's efforts in recent months, in particular since the election. There's been some attempts to improve and deal with the appeals backlog. The shift has reduced the overall caseload by about 10%. There's just under now 4,000 active cases as of the 19th of September. That's from 4,500. I get that sometimes there'll be disagreements in the scheme, but in my opinion, especially in recent years, the scheme was being managed not by sensible planning decisions or internal review, but rather by reference to the AAT. And that was just a dumb, terrible way to manage the scheme. I'm deeply conscious that one way to help resolve the series of cases is to have a better initial planning process, and also to have more transparent internal review, and for the agency to provide written reasons rather than waiting to the door of court. I want to make sure that the model litigant rules are followed in all cases. I think there's been an overuse of external lawyers, and it's created an unfair David and Goliath sort of struggle. So it's clear to me that we need to improve the future processes. But as part of that, we must deal with the legacy cases where people right now are in the AAT. I'm interested in the things that participants know are needed for a clearer, less adversarial, more efficient process. But we need a circuit breaker to consider individual participant cases and disputed support. So I'm interested to understand how long should it take to get an outcome. I'm sure that there'll be a lot of items here about how the NDIA can do things better, but also what kind of support is needed to navigate dispute mechanism processes. I appreciate Jean and every Australian Council and Mary Mallet for co-hosting this. Any new processes, be it for alternative dispute resolution in the future, but also dealing with the existing cases, must have continued scrutiny and input from people with disability. And also there needs to be additional advocacy support if we're going to try and do something with the cases, the existing cases, and give people greater support. So one, we want to set up an oversight committee to look at the existing cases. The oversight committee's got to be trusted people from the disability sector, advocates. I'm pleased to announce that the oversight committee will be chaired by Graham Innes, Australia's former disability discrimination commissioner. What they're going to do is the oversight committee, once it's created, those members will appoint expert reviewers. These are independent people from the agency and the agency lawyers to blitz the thousands of cases at the AAT. To be very clear, This is a voluntary process. No one loses their place in the AATQ. No one needs to, it doesn't, participating in a review of their matter doesn't mean that they have to accept what the review says. This is an entirely voluntary extra effort to try and cut the bullshit and just get on with the issues. We'll be consulting with people with disability and their advocates and experts at every stage. We'll start with an initial trial process of 15 or 20 matters. And if that works, we want to get to 2,000 plus matters, which are currently in the waiting lists before Christmas. Although I would love to see everyone's matter looked at as soon as possible and just given a view. I am of the view that many of these matters where participants are arguing for things can and should be fixed. They shouldn't require a participant to have to fight with a big end of town lawyer all the way to the door of court. I think the current situation is repellent and repugnant, and it is not acceptable for this government to behave in, for any government to behave in this way. So no one would lose their place in the queue by this additional process. I get that for a lot of people, they'll be basically having a version of this question. The NDIA has been stuffing around with me for a long time. I'm tired, I'm at my wit's end. I'm sick of getting reports. It's costing a lot, the participants suffering. What is gonna change? Well, I wanna say the bad old days I want dispensed with. I wanna knock off and resolve thousands of these matters. And by that, I mean resolve in the interests of the participant. There'll be proper supports with an oversight committee. I just want to make very clear on behalf of participants, as far as I'm concerned, and I say this clearly to the NDIA, you are now in a different world, NDIA. The adversarial approach is not the approach which I support. As a minister, I want the process to change so participants are treated as much better, with much better respect than they currently have. Listen, on that sort of introduction, I also want to make clear that when people, if we have this alternative review process, it's without prejudice. People don't have to do it. They don't have to accept it. If they've got questions, though, there'll be a 1-800 number, which will be supported by advocates. Advocates will then be involved in helping provide resources for reports. And ultimately, if an offer is made by expert review, then the participant should have the right to be able to get some agreed legal support just to assess, is it in their interests? Anyway, why don't I hand over to Matt now? And, you know, I acknowledge that Matt has certainly got things moving since he's been Chief Counsel. So I'd ask you to listen to him with an open mind. It's not more of the same or business as usual. Over to you, Matt. Thank you.
And if you don't mind, Minister, I'll just jump in because I didn't introduce Matt properly. Matt is the new Chief Counsel at the NDIA, and I have been fortunate enough to be part of a number of meetings that Matt has been in with a number of appeals advocates, and I've been really pleased to see how sincere he is about listening. I hope that Matt is able to set a good example for the future of the NDIS, the NDIA, and everybody else that works with him and alongside him. So, with that, I'll hand over. Thanks, Matt.
Yeah. Thanks, Jean, and thanks, Minister. Good afternoon, everybody. Look, I just want to first start by acknowledging that I'm calling from Ngunnawal land here in Canberra and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging from this land, but also all the countries where you're all calling in from this afternoon. As the Minister and Jean mentioned, I've quite recently been made Chief Counsel at the agency. I've been here for a little over 3 months. And in that time, I've spent a fair bit of time speaking with advocates and legal aid people and listening to what are the pressures in the system. Those people have been very generous with their time, and I really appreciate the time people have spent helping me understand, helping the agency understand the pressures. I think what's quite clear is that we also need to listen to the experience of participants who've been through this or even are within the AAT at the moment, and that's why we're here today. So I just want to acknowledge that I expect that many people calling in today and within Zoom, within the meeting, would have had a very terrible experience. I acknowledge comments from Minister Shorten. I'm expecting what I'm going to hear today will be quite confronting. You know, I'll be honest, I'm a little bit nervous, and a little bit nervous about participating in today, because I do acknowledge the experiences that people have had. And I've heard that. I've heard that coming through. But I feel it really is incumbent on us to listen directly from participants, to hear those experiences and to learn from them. I appreciate people have questions today. I will do my best to answer those questions when I can. I'll try to give as fulsome answer I can. Some questions, however, I won't be able to answer. So I think one of the things Jean mentioned at the start, and I don't anticipate this to be the only time that we come and talk to people and listen. I think the Minister mentioned model litigant obligations, which are very important, important obligations on the government when we're in disputes. And I think part of those obligations are to listen to people. And it's something that we've been working on what is the best way to do that. So I don't anticipate today will be the only time that we will want to hear from people, that I want to hear from people. So look, this is maybe some questions I have to come back to people on. So there's been a fair bit of focus on numbers. And Mr. Shorten did mention some numbers. And yes, the caseload has reduced since May. And I think that's good. It's encouraging. But I do want to acknowledge that each of those numbers are a person. And if you're one of the cases that are one of the numbers that are still in the AAT or have been through that doesn't help you, that the caseload's coming down. So I think I certainly acknowledge and what I've seen is there are things that we need to work on as the agency. And I think we've got some things in play and in train that we really hope will make a difference. Minister Shorten did mention the expert review process that we're hoping to come out and consult with people. I think setting up the oversight committee for that is a really big part of that. We need to make sure that there was an arm's length or a body that was a bit arm's length from the agency to make sure that whatever was set up was independent. And that's the work that Graham Innes will be leading. And, you know, I thank him for sticking his hand up to help with that work. I think that he will be leading some consultation on that, what that process actually looks like for people. So that's certainly not settled yet. One of the things we have really heard from people I've heard is that participants and their advocates or representatives want to hear from an agency staff member, not a lawyer. And we do have lawyers in the system. They do help us, you know, push, make sure the cases are progressed as quickly as possible. We don't want people to be delayed. But we have heard that people want to speak to an agency staff member, so that's one of the things that we've really been trying to roll out in a much greater number of getting our agency staff members to lean in and be the people that contact participants to talk about the case. So that's probably the most significant thing that I guess have progressed over recent months, and we're getting some good feedback on that. So as I said, you know, I'm here to listen today, here to answer questions where I can. You know, there is a pretty broad acknowledgement that we do need to look at what we're doing and how we're running things and put the participant back at the centre of external review. There is a statutory scheme that we're responsible for administering, and as part of that, there will be times when you disagree with our decisions. And it is really important that you have that absolute right to go to an external review body to question our decisions. And I think we really do want to acknowledge that. It's a right, and that needs to remain. So without further ado, Jean, if I can hand back to you and the forum and we'll see where we go. But thank you, everybody. Appreciate your time this afternoon. And I also really, I guess, for those that will share this afternoon, I just want to acknowledge up front your courage, because it is some pretty confronting information, and we are here to listen. So thank you for your time and courage today. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. And yeah, thank you for making it clear that you're both yourself and Minister Shorten are personally committed to listening. So we'll hold you to that, don't you worry. But for right now, we don't have too much time. So I will I will just put somebody on the spot right now and ask if Bob Buckley, if you're happy to ask the question that you popped in the chat. I've clicked a button that will let you unmute. I think you have to click something. All right.
Well, my first question really was if there's an alternative process, does it actually stop you from, does it slow down the AAT process? If you go to the alternative process, is your AAT process held up until that process, or do the two proceed in parallel?
Okay. I will ask the minister to respond.
All right. Well, Matt's in charge and he's in charge of the legal detail, but the principle I have is that the alternative process shouldn't delay the AAT. It's like a train track. It's concurrent. Secondly, I'm hoping that this pilot works, that the review of the matter done by someone independent of the agency, oversighted by Graham Minister's Committee, will take no longer than a month. Basically, this is an additional offer, and what I'm trying to do is organise government resources, agency resources, to work out how to resolve matters rather than have a fight. It doesn't affect anyone's legal standing if they don't have to take the offers, but I personally believe that with a more conciliatory, less adversarial approach with instructions and people not from the external law firms who are making a lot of money out of running these matters to the NDIA, but independent experts who understand disability with the aim to fix it, not to fight it. I hope that answers your question, Bob.
Thank you, Minister. I think we'll throw over to Nick Avery. If you're ready, Nick, Tamara should ask you to turn your mic off. There you go.
So my question is around the NDIA's operational guidelines. They were changed around the NDIS internal review of decision processes around September, October last year to remove the requirement for the internal review team to actually speak directly with the participant or their nominee. And that has resulted in a lot of very harmful decisions because the participant was left out of that decision-making process. Will those operational guidelines be changed back to the requirement they must interact with the participant before making that decision? And how soon will that occur, because it's still causing harm now?
Matt? Listen, it's the minister here. I blew the whistle on that with advocates last year. The idea that you have an internal review where you don't actually speak to the person, it's a bit like having a bus company that doesn't pick up passengers. So what is the latest on that, Matt?
Yeah, I think, as I mentioned just in the opening, I think it's a really key piece of feedback we've heard around this need for agency staff to contact people. We've been doing it, as I said, in the AAT program. I think it's been something that's well received. The question goes to the internal review. I'm not able to sort of talk about the change of the operational guidance that changed that. It's probably one I'll have to take on notice and come back to a future session. But I do know that the internal review team are now increasing their contact with participants through the internal review process. So that is certainly something that's coming back. It is happening at the moment, not in every single internal review, but it is something which is coming back. So we'll hear you on that comment. I don't know if it will lead to a change in the operational guideline. That will need to be a comeback one, but I do know there is contact coming back on for internal review people.
Thank you. I think some of these are going to clearly be ongoing conversations. Next up, though, I think we'll go to Kayla from DRAS. Kayla.
Hi. My name's Kayla. I'm an advocate with Disability Rights Advocacy Service on Kaurna Land in Adelaide. I just wanted to ask Matt, when you were talking about this new process that you've been trialing over the past few months in terms of having the NDIS representatives contact participants directly, just like to making sure like how we're safeguarding around that, because something that we've heard from our clients is that they have been contacted directly by NDIS representatives, asking them to settle, not really giving them much of an opportunity to discuss the new plan, what it would look like with an advocate, for example, maybe feeling a bit pressured, and that would happen without the knowledge of an advocate or also the NDIA lawyer, which, you know, as an advocacy service, we're completely on board with not wanting to have, you know, so many external lawyers as well, and spending that money on the NDIS and wanting to spend it on plans instead. But yeah, so I guess my question is, how are you going to safeguard to make sure that participants' rights are still protected while giving them more an efficient process through the new trial you've been doing?
Yeah, look, thanks for the question. And I don't think we'd call it a trial. I think it's something that we want to do ongoing. It's a clear piece of feedback we've had that people want to talk to an agency staff member, not an external lawyer. So I think we can say it's something that we will keep going with. Look, the expectation from me is that a participant should be contacted through their preferred method or however is best suitable for them. So if they have an advocate, that's what the contact should go through. And there shouldn't be timeframes around that offer. I mean, obviously, resolving a matter does mean putting an offer. So in some cases, that will be everything the participant has sought. And in some cases, it won't be. It'll be whatever the evidence that we have is supportive of. So I think there's probably two things I'd like to commit to. And you can hold me to that if we have these future sessions. If it's not happening, is that if there's an advocate involved, we should be going through the advocate. And we shouldn't be giving timeframes for participants to consider those offers. So, you know, there might be, the tribunal might be pushing us with their timeframes. So that could be another factor we've got to think about. There could be other reasons that, you know, we want to get things moving along. But as a general principle, both those should stand. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, sorry, just unmuting. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, I'll feed that back into our service and see what we're thinking with that. Yeah.
And if it's not happening, we should hear about it, because both those things should be part of this participant-centred contact arrangements.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from Ange Horton. Have we got you there, Ange? And then I'll ask... Minister or Matt, which of you would like to take that question, but we'll wait to hear what Ange's question is first. We've got Ange.
And my question was just around whether or not this alternative review process is just to blitz the numbers at the AAT at the moment, or is this going to be an ongoing thing?
So I'll let Minister decide. Yep.
Initially, it's to reduce the existing caseload because they're the people under the most pressure. But the other piece of work is to develop and use the experience of this to have alternative dispute resolution. So, yeah, I mean, we've got three things we want to do, Ange. One is I want to bring a lot more of the planning decisions in-house. I want planners to talk directly to the people that are building their plans for. Once the plan's built and we're reviewing it, but I want to see some continuity between the family and the participant and the person who built the plan. If there then becomes a problem that the plan isn't what people thought, there's internal review, but then I want to give alternative dispute resolution where, and this is my early thoughts, this isn't the final decision of the agency. The agency is governed by a board as well as a minister, but when someone's unhappy with internal review, there's an expert independent mediator who looks at it. The participant can have an advocate present, but I don't want the agency to lawyer up. And we've got to talk, the focus has got to be on a solution, not a legal attrition which wears down the participant into accepting something which they don't really want. And also without the cost of going to the AAT, there'll still be external review, Ange, but I'd like to have a better alternative dispute resolution, which the focus is on resolution and genuine conciliation, not playing games and multiple hearings at the AAT and then an offer. And if you've lasted a year and a half, then an offer at the door of the court. Because some of these matters are too urgent to take this long.
Thank you, Minister. I'll just end with one short question from Sarah Butler. Sarah, I'll ask you to just try and be quick, and then we can move on to the next section. Thank you. There you go.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Minister. What changes are being made so participants don't have to go backwards and forwards to the AAT to get decisions overturned for their supports? And if something's already been funded, how can we ensure that it's funded in the participants' current, subsequent and future plans without them having to be told by the NDIA to go back to the AAT again to get the same decision overturned?
Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you.
Should we give that one to you to start with, Minister, or Matt? Matt. So, yeah, we hear this one a lot. Why do people have to go back and fight for something that they've already done previously?
Yeah, look, as a general principle, and if I'm talking sort of generics, you know, if the tribunal has looked at an issue that we've disputed and made a ruling on it on the information they had, that should be the position. And I think we only have about 97-98% of matters are resolved without going to the tribunal. So if we've agreed with something that on the evidence, we've looked at it and we've said, no, that evidence supports what the participant's asking for, as a general principle, we shouldn't have to go back, or the participants shouldn't have to go back and ask for that same thing again. I guess the circumstances, I'm talking in general, if something's changed, circumstances have changed, that might mean something's different. But I agree with the general principle that once we've agreed to something, we've looked at the evidence and we've agreed that's the way it should be, I think that should stay.
Gene, it's Matt, it's Bill here. Something which we've got to look to going forward is that whilst every person's unique and individual, there are some issues which are generic. And where there's a standard set, those decisions at some point need to be published, or the guidelines need to be a lot clearer in the agency so that people aren't having to re-argue over things which, you know, of course everyone's different, but some things are common sense and common claims. So I think the existence of clearer guidelines and previous decisions makes it easier for planners, participants, advocates, just to know this, what's in the swim lanes.
Thank you, Minister. And Matt, this, yeah, I mean, Michelle McGarrigle is here today, who many of you will be familiar with, her son's case. Yeah, we'll get to you in a little bit, Michelle. But yeah, this the questions coming through in the chat are really thoughtful and smart, and I'm sorry that we can't get through them all today, but I will ask somebody from my team to pop a link in the chat. We've set up a new section on the website. We've just hit publish. This is for later, but I'll just, in case you want to open them up for later, for anything that we can't address today or that you want us to follow up on later with the minister and or the agency, whoever's appropriate, we'll do our best to use everything that you've given us today, in addition to everything that we've heard in the past, and make a frequently asked questions page, and hopefully that will help make all of this clearer for all of us, and help make it a bit sort of clearer to the agency as well, what matters to you all the most. But for right now, I'm going to ask if you wouldn't mind using the civility tool again just quickly, and this will help us sort of give us a quick overview of what we've just heard from the Minister and Matt. So I think Sophie's going to pop that into the chat again now, or if you've still got the link open from last time. There we go. Okay, so the link is, for anybody that can't click it in the chat, menti.com, M-I-N-T-I, / A-L-J-M-5-C-C-N-1-D-B. There's probably a shorter version of that somewhere. You want to bring it up, Soph, on the screen, please? There we go. menti.com. Forget about the forward slash bit, and then enter the code 6169702, or use the QR code with your smartphone camera. We've got 121 people in there ready to go. And I didn't press it, so I haven't got it. Sophie, can you remind me what the question says? There we go. How do you, so on the screen right now, we've got a series of answers to the question, how do you feel about the proposed changes you've heard about today? Cautiously optimistic, nervous, concerned, hopeful, sounds good, but actions speak louder than words. Positive, but skeptical, tentatively positive. I'm going too fast, but it feels like the overall sort of sentiment is hopeful, skeptical, and somewhere in between, which I, you know, I understand exactly why people are feeling really cautious, because we've all been burnt. great news, sounds hopeful, okay. We'll share the details in full with you afterwards, and we'll also make sure that anybody who missed out on that can do it again later. Thank you, Sophie. So we'll just we'll move on to the next part of hearing from all of you. It'd be good if we could shift the focus a little bit now to what do you all think is important for the people making decisions to consider in any sort of changes going forward to the AAT process, or more broadly, or more specifically, the external review process that the Minister described? So, again, we'll ask people to keep the questions coming in through the chat, but also now is a really good moment for you to share anything that you think is really important and helpful that might prevent problems further down the track. Let's start with Michelle, who I promised to get back to earlier, Michelle McGarrigle. There you go.
Hi, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, I actually took the NDIS to federal court for the decision to be made about how reasonable and necessary is read in the legislation. My question, I guess, mainly is to Matt, because Bill Shorten is very knowledgeable around this federal decision. My concern is that too many applicants are having to go to the AAT because the NDIA as an agency is not using that federal court decision. The number of AAT matters that have been decided referencing my case, which shows that it needs to be used sooner rather than later, It could avoid the whole backlog that is happening at the AAT if the NDIA applied it correctly. I've had to actually inform staff at the NDIA individually that the decision exists. I got told at the end of last year that an AAT decision doesn't last forever, and I've had to actually send staff members on more than one occasion the link. So if the staff in the agency aren't being informed of the legislation and how it's supposed to be read, the problem is always going to be broken. How are you looking at addressing the training of the staff to make sure that in-house the decisions are being made correctly and by the right guidelines? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for very, very good question. Thank you. And, you know, obviously appreciate the effort it takes to run a matter right through to that sort of appeal point. Look, I think training is a really big piece in the puzzle. We're pretty committed, certainly from the legal space, to be implementing further training on administrative decision making. And I think it's really important. So I agree with you, I acknowledge it, and I think that's something we are committed to doing. And that's really important. I think one of the other things I think the agency has been, you know, putting a lot of effort into as well is the publishing guidance to sort of assist with that interpretation or the way in which reasonable and necessary is applied. I hear the decision of the Federal Court, and I, you know, I'm aware of that. It's still quite a complex process to make that decision. And I think the operational guidance and a lot of the work the agency has been doing in putting out guidance to assist participants and also advocates and people help them to understand how the agency applying that, I think is helpful. But I think training is probably the key to it. So I agree, we are committed to rolling out more training.
Excellent question. Thanks, Michelle. I have made a mistake and gone a bit over time. My apologies, and thank you all for your grace in my first attempt at emceeing something big like this. Not really too afraid to admit I'm a bit nervous too. So luckily we have an excellent and lovely and warm and forgiving community. So we've only got 4 minutes left. I'll invite the minister now to reflect on what he's heard from all of you today, and then we'll try and get wrapped up by 2:30. Thank you.
Hey, thanks very much, Jane, and thanks very much, Matt, and thanks very much to everyone participating. I also acknowledge the captioners and the Auslan peeps and the work they're doing and the tech support. I think that people have been let down by the NDIO for a number of years and by my predecessors. So we've got to just be truthful about that. I know people want everything changed immediately, and there's a fair bit of trauma and pain. Look, I can't change everything immediately. I can promise you that working with you, this blitz to deal with the legacy cases is just dealing with one part of the system, but it's by dealing with this, I want to help build trust in everything else. I also recognise that the best way to avoid legal disputation is to have a better initial planning process and pre-planning process, to have greater transparency on what you can and can't claim, to better train up the planners and the internal reviewers about what's happened before so that we're not constantly reinventing the wheel. But I'm very committed to having an internal dispute resolution process, alternative, you know, mediation. And I've asked Graham Innes and the Oversight Committee to prepare not just what we're doing on the current cases, but what the alternative dispute resolution should look like by early December. That will be robust. I want to take the lawyers, the agency's lawyers, out of that alternative dispute resolution because it's an unfair contest. I want the agency to write down the reasons why it makes a decision rather than constantly sort of, in my opinion, too often delaying the facts. So people are get a cut in a plan but don't even know why. So that will happen. I appreciate already the solutions coming through on the chat room. That's very good. And also, I just need to be very clear, the only way the pilot can work, or indeed alternative the blitz, is by properly funding advocacy. I get there's a strain on resources. Amanda Rishworth, the Minister for Social Services, and I are working on making sure there's more advocacy resources. I understand in any process of trust building, we've got to level the equation so that the participant feels empowered and resourced to understand and make a decision, not be coerced into making a decision. Nothing we've said today changes the existing rights of anyone. This is just a genuine effort to deal with something which has been put in the too hard basket with you. I'll stop at that point because I know time and Jean might want to say something on that.
Thanks, Minister. My apologies. I've made us go over time. I think it's clear that there's a lot more to talk about, but I really appreciate your presence here today, everybody. And I apologise most sincerely to everybody that would have liked to have been part of this but wasn't able to. And I promise you that we will do everything in our power to make sure that this is inclusive for everyone going forward. But we are at 2:30 now, and I know lots of people have places to be and things to do. So we were hoping to do one more mood check to compare with how everybody was feeling at the beginning of the session. So if you need to rush off, that's fine. You're welcome to, and we can we'll follow up with you all via email and links on socials after this, with all of the links that we shared today. And we'll be back in touch really soon. Make sure you're signed up to the Every Australian Counts mailing list if you aren't already, so that we can keep you in the loop. Right now up on the screen, 73 or so people are in the civility tool, and I can see three graphs on the screen in response to the question, how have you found this session? I feel I know more now is sort of halfway between a little bit closer to, it's roughly halfway between strongly disagree and strongly agree. It's sort of 23 people said strongly disagree and 26 ticked something right in the middle there. Otherwise, again, roughly in the middle, people said, I feel included in this process. So 28 people were roughly halfway between strongly disagree and agree again, said, I feel included in this process. It looks like we've got much more work to do. And then finally, I feel more hopeful is similar sort of results with a bit more sort of weighted towards strongly disagree, but largely in the middle at 2.6. So thank you all for being really honest with us. And there's a lot of hardship. You know, people have had really horrific experiences, and I hope, and I'm sure that you all do too, that that it wasn't all for nothing, that we can use this to build a much brighter future for everybody who needs support from the NDIS and or other systems. So, we're 2:32, so I'll let you all go, but thank you all most sincerely, and please feel free to stay engaged so that we can keep this going. Cheers. Thank you all.
Thanks, Jean. Thanks very much to the team, you and the team for today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.